So, just a recap here. So, this is the fifth chapter of Bhagavad Gita. This how the Bhagavad Gita flow is happening. So, in the first chapter, like when battle of Kurukshetra started, Arjuna gets bewildered. He doesn't want to kill his family, friends, and he is confused, and he asks, In the second chapter, he surrenders to Krishna and he accepts Krishna as his guru. And then he requests Krishna to enlighten him. And Krishna, in the second chapter, he says how it is body and soul are different. And he says how giving up is not beneficial for you, giving up the war, being a Kshatriya. And also he explains about different things. He explains about Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, and different processes. So that's why second chapter is called the summary of the entire Bhagavad Gita. After explaining that, at the end of second chapter, Krishna says, talks about Buddhi Yoga. And he says, you should actually, by the intelligence, by using the, to keep all the abominable things away by using Buddhi Yoga. And so Arjuna thinks like, Krishna is saying, when Krishna says, keep all the abominable activities away by using Buddhi Yoga. And Arjuna gets confused. So Krishna saying to keep all the activities away. So for that Krishna, again, like Arjuna asks Krishna, should I act or should I renounce? So here, when Arjuna asks that question, should I perform karma or should I take renunciation means, should I act, shall I do karma or shall I take renounced order of life, means sannyas, just like taking sannyas and going into the forest. So for that, Krishna explains karma yoga. That karma yoga mainly deals with performing karma or different types of karma and how one should perform karma. And there Krishna explains performing nishkama karma yoga, means performing the activity without any fruitive, without expecting any fruitive results. So when Krishna says that, then while saying that, Krishna says, for a person who is engaged in karma, the most dangerous enemy is the lust. So you should keep the lust away using your intelligence. So for that, Krishna again gives transcendental knowledge. This, that fourth chapter, Krishna says using the knowledge, how to keep these abominable activities away. So for that Krishna gives this entire chapter of transcendental knowledge about transcendental knowledge means how to perform work in service of Krishna. That is it also explains briefly about how the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita is coming in the guru disciple succession. Okay, and then at the end of that chapter, again Arjuna asks one more question. Here Arjuna asks, what does Arjuna ask? Arjuna asks question, Arjuna said, oh Krishna, first of all you asked me to renounce the world. Then again, you recommend work with devotion. Now, will you kindly tell me definitely what is this? Which of the two is more beneficial? So, the title under title of this chapter is performing the work in the Krishna consciousness, or here in this chapter, renunciation means renunciation of karma. Just a minute. In this chapter, so another title of this chapter is Karma Sannyasa Yoga. Means, so in this chapter, sannyasa means it used to indicate karma sannyasa. Means in the second chapter, Arjuna was preparing to take sannyas from the social order of life. Like he was a grihastha, he wants to take sannyas and go to the forest. That is one kind of sannyas. And karma sannyas means just give up the activity only. That is karma sannyas. So here Arjuna is asking which of the two is better, karma sannyas or renunciation? Because we all know that, like previously discussed, why does the soul come into this material world? Soul come into this material world to enjoy independent of Krishna. So if I don't enjoy only, then I convey to the Krishna that I don't want to stay in this material world. So I can go back to Godhead. That's what the sannyasis do. They renounce the entire material world and they only engage themselves. They go to forest and they sit in the caves and meditate. So that way they try to free from the contamination of this material world. So now Arjuna, being a householder, being in the society man, it is not possible for him, but still he is asking, like, should I give up work? And so in this chapter, we'll be discussing how Krishna convinces him how to act in spiritual, how to act in Krishna consciousness. That is, stay in this world. Okay. Don't give up your work. And he explains about, you should not think that you are the only doer. You are, so like he explains about three doers. You know? So for any activity to happen, there are three doers. Okay. And then Krishna explains, like, when we have the knowledge, like, you know, who is the ultimate doer and who is the ultimate sanctioner, or who is behind all these activities, then we'll develop equal vision towards everything. And what is the ultimate peace formula? Means when we are working, when you are working in this material world, and we may develop different kinds of anxieties, due to misidentification, due to ignorance, or due to some kind of illusion. So who can be like, who, how to get out of this, all these anxieties and be peaceful? So that is a peace formula that we'll be discussing. Okay. So how Krishna convinces, when Arjuna asks this question, to should I work or just give up the work? So Krishna says, the personality of Godhead replied, the renunciation of work and the work in devotion are both are good for liberation. But of the two, work in devotion service is better than renunciation of work. So without Krishna consciousness, mere renunciation of the work does not actually purify the heart of a conditioned soul. But work in devotion purifies the heart, hence automatically elevates one from the fruitive platform, the self-centric active work. Therefore, action in Krishna consciousness is always superior to renunciation, which always entails a risk of falling. Okay. So here I clearly read Krishna's response and what it means. So Krishna is saying, if you renounce your activity and just do meditation or go into cave and meditate, that is also fine, because that way you will not get into a lot of sinful activities and you'll not be engaging too much sin. But Krishna says, and the working is also better, but of the two, working in devotion is far better, because as you know, we are all conditioned souls and our tendency is to work. And our, like, for a person to renounce everything, he need to have a lot of knowledge how he should renounce and how just to maintaining the bare necessities of life. That is, he should have a lot of physical and mental ability. And we are all not brought up in that such a condition. And also, it is not practical. If everybody renounces in this world and goes to the forest, then forest will be like cities. So it is not practical also. And so that's why, like, a very few rare souls, they will renounce and go to the forest, and they will attain perfection. Very rarely they will attain perfection. But if one engages in devotion service and being in this material world, is working with his family and doing his job and staying in his home, he can attain the same perfection that a sage in the caves of Himalayas can achieve. Maharaj says, when a person engages with sincerely in devotion service, working everything for the sake of Krishna and offering his life or his every and his or her activity in service of Krishna, he is far more better than even if she is a simple housewife, she is far more better than a great yogi in the Himalayan caves, because she is doing what is supposed to be done. No? So there is nice example. Okay, like in a street, there was while we are walking, somebody finds a bag means like a purse, wallet. Okay, if he finds that and he sees it, okay, there's a lot of cash and there are ID, credit cards, and there is some driving license, everything is there in the wallet. Okay, and there are three ways of using that, reacting to that situation. When we find a wallet, we shall take three persons. Okay, first person, he sees the cash and he sees the credit cards or anything valuables in that wallet, and he says, okay, this my God gifted. I got this lottery. I'm lucky today. I got some money free of cost. So he takes that cash and he just enjoys it. That is one kind of activity. Second thing is, that person says, oh, this is not mine. I should not touch this property. This is not my property. I should leave it off. So he goes off, walks away. That is second type of person. And third type of person is, he finds that he takes up this wallet and sees the money and sees cards and see the driving license. And he takes them and takes to a police officer and gives it to the police officer and says, I found this property in the road. I'm just saying, no, this I found it. It is to be given to that concerned person. So, and he makes a proper arrangement so that the lost property is given back to the owner. So among these three, whose attitude is perfect? There are many theories which will justify each and every activity. Okay, the first person, when he finds the money on the wallet on the road, because nobody is around and he found the wallet, because means it's his property. So he can enjoy. Somebody says that is also perfect. But according to law of karma, if you get anything without making endeavor for that, means without working for it, you will be entangled in karma. Means you will be held responsible. Even according to law of the state or the country, if you find any money which is not yours, it should be reported to the government. So first person is hardcore materialist. When he gets something in his life, some advantage, or either cash or nice family or property, he'll just say, okay, this God gift is my karma, and he just keeps on enjoying that. So that kind of person, it may be due to his good karma, he might be getting the facilities. But if he keeps on enjoying it, there's in no time, he'll get entangled in the material world and again fall down. So second person is like this renunciates. So this material world is not my property. So I should not enjoy this. So I will go to the forest and abstain from enjoying. I will do severe austerities. I will not eat. I will not wear anything. I will just barely live in the caves and then get out of this material world and attain liberation. That is second kind of reaction. And third kind of reaction is, you understand, yes, this material world is not my property, but this is a property of Krishna. So I will engage everything in the service of Krishna. That is called Yukta Vairagya. So that's why Prabhupada says, don't be a materialist or a fruity worker. That is first kind of person. Or don't be a false renunciate. Just renouncing and going into the forest or coming, falling down sometime, like after a few years, you will fall down again because we don't have that ability to fully control our senses. So we take to the enjoyment of material nature, material things again. That is very dangerous also. So, but the third kind of person, he engages whatever he has in the service of Krishna. And if he, and he also, gets the material facilities as a prasada, means just like when a master and servant is there, when serving the master will eat first and then give his remnant to the servant. In the same way, a devotee first offers everything to Krishna and takes whatever is coming after Krishna enjoys it, whatever is coming as prasada. So that way he is freed from all kind of karma. So that is called Yukta Vairagya, means engaging everything in the service of Krishna. So Krishna says, if you renounce and go to the forest, it is very difficult for you. There is a good chance of falling down also, because you think that you are doing everything, but actually you are not the one who is doing, because there are modes of nature. So Lord Buddha says the cause of all the pain and suffering is ignorance. Okay. When we think we are only, everything depends on our endeavor. And it just because of I didn't do properly, it didn't work. Or just because I did properly, it worked. So this kind of thinking is not fully in knowledge. Okay. So how does the sinful actions work? Like the root cause of our suffering is sins, that we are saying, right? So it starts with avidya, ignorance. Due to ignorance, because of we have active senses, our senses will always demand sense gratification. So this sinful desires will be there in us, and the sinful desires will lead to sinful actions, and the sinful actions will gives rise to reactions, unmanifested reactions. That is called apraradha karma. When the karma is manifested, it is called manifested reaction or prarabdha karma. And this prarabdha karma will lead to suffering. But there is, like, when we perform one activity, there are some karmas which will give instant reaction. But there are some karmas which will give reaction after many, after a long time. That is called apraradha karma. So, prarabdha karma, we suffer and we get rid of the sin. But aprarabdha karma, it will wait, and when later on, it will not only gives a sinful disposition, it will give the reactions later. So due to we performing a sinful activity, we will have this tendency, because I'll give an example. When a thief, when he first steals anything, he will have different kinds of fears and and also internally he will be a part of his heart is saying that whatever you are doing is wrong. But if that person does commit that simple activity, and it is very easy, there is a good tendency that he will do it again and again. That's why when a crime happens, what will the police officer do? They will take out the records of all the previous criminals and just double check. Is there a chance that this person has this crime? Is there a chance this person or this person? So they will first check all the previous sinful persons, previous criminals. And most of the time it is that person who does that kind of sinful activities. So this is a cycle of sin, because this is due to the ignorance. Because when we are in ignorance, we don't know, we just commit our sinful activities just as per the direction of our senses. So and this knowledge is given through the Vedic scriptures. Just by focusing on the devotional service of Krishna, we not only get enlightened, no, and get the knowledge of what is important, what is not important, what is to be performed and what is not to be performed, and how to engage ourselves in devotional service to Krishna so that we can overcome this tendency of sinful reaction. Because this cycle is there, right? Like if we accidentally commit any sinful activity also, there is a good chance that it will pull you up. No? For example, when a child is there and the child doesn't know what is ice cream. Even if there is ice cream, the child will not go and eat the ice cream. But if by accidentally sometime, if the child happens to eat and child tastes that this ice cream is it, and it is so sweet and so nice. And from that time onwards, whenever the child goes into any place and where there is any shop, the child first will look for ice cream or chocolate. As long as the child does not have a taste for that, the wrong thing. No? I'm just giving the ice cream because it can be any sinful activity. No? Because I'm saying, what is this cycle? How, no? Like we, like, no, we can consider this for any of the, what you call, addiction. Like smoking, drinking alcohol, meat eating, gambling. No? Like as long as we don't have the habit of gambling, we don't know, like, you know, we don't make any effort to learn it and gamble it. No? But when we see people who are so addicted to gambling, they can hardly resist without gambling. We feel, why these persons are so much addicted? How can they just keep everything in the, you know, at stake? No? They keep their hard-earned money and lose the hard-earned money in the gambling. So this is because we didn't get that taste. We didn't get have that initial sinful, tendency, because we don't have that sinful disposition. But if one of our friend takes us and show how to perform gambling and how to win cash and how to play that gambling, then there is a good tendency that when you have money and when you have free time, we'll go on gambling, go for gambling. So that is, so the sins are committed without any restrictions when our senses are not controlled by the knowledge of devotional service to Krishna. Means by, if there is no knowledge, if we only act on our senses, like, no, whatever we feels good, whatever is, whatever we think is gratifying our senses, then there is a good chance that we end up in a cycle of the sin. So that's why we have to take the shelter of, we have to always, try to implement the knowledge of scriptures like Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam in our life, and understand the purpose of human form of life, and use this life very responsibly. So when we, then Krishna says about the three doers. No? To complete any activity, the three parties are involved. Who are they? That individual soul. We have already discussed, right? How everyone is an individual soul, not the body, but the soul. And the Supreme Lord Krishna, who sanctions. It is said that, like, man proposes, God disposes. So individual soul desires, I would like to have this. And Krishna sees it. Krishna sees the desire of that person and sanctions it. And material nature or the Durga Devi, she facilitates this. Okay. Based on what Krishna says, yes, for what? Krishna has sanctioned. Okay. So desires cannot be negated, but the devotional service, the desire is changed only for the service of the Lord in the place of desire for sense gratification. So the so-called affection for the family, society, country, etc., consists of different phases of sense gratification. When this desire is changed to the sense satisfaction of Lord, it is called devotional service. So here, right, when it comes to three doers, I think something is missing here. So first, soul desires, you know, like soul desires to do something, any activity, you know, even if it is like, you know, permitted by the shastras, or is it like, you know, good activity or bad activity or illegal or sinful activity. First, soul desires, you know, like you need to gratify your senses. Then, okay, there is a shop nearby. I can go and rob the money from that shop. He desires that. And Supreme Lord facilitates based on the karma. Because based on your previous activities in your previous life or in this life, Lord will facilitate certain amount of free will to the jiva. Means he can be able to do certain activities freely for some time. Lord facilitated that. No? We gave the example, right? When a cow is taken to a grass grass field, and a rope is tied to the neck of that cow, and a knot is put there. So that cow can be able to eat the grass in that area until which the rope allows it to. No, rope is like the length of the rope. So you understood, right, what I'm trying to say? So that cow, when it is tied in a grass field, it will be able to eat the grass within the circumference of the rope. So in the same way, Lord will give the free will. That free will is the length of the rope. How much free will that you will get, it is based on our previous karma. So, and based on that, Lord sanctions that. Like if the desire of the soul is within that limit, then Lord sanctions it, and material nature facilitates, and material nature will give the ideas. Okay, now you want to rob the shop, right? Okay, now put a mask on your face, and then, you know, go in the night time, how to disable the cameras, and how to unlock the door, and how to rob the store. This entire intelligence is provided by the material nature. So that is, for any activity, there are three doers. No, first the soul has to desire, and Lord has to sanction it, and the material nature has to facilitate it. So, and irrespective of what kind of activity then the jiva will get the reaction for it. No, if he does a good activity, it will get good reactions. It will get bad activity, it will get bad actions. No, but if one wants to be freed from all the reactions, then he has to perform the activity in the devotional service. So that's why it is there, right? No, when the desire is changed to for the satisfaction of the Lord, when we perform our activity in the devotion to Lord Krishna, the work without any reaction, that is called akama or nishkama karma yoga. Where did it go? I think something is missing here. So we are saying that how the condition jiva works. No, the jiva works on, like, when we say some slides are not showing up. While explaining the modes of nature, while explaining the three doers, before that Krishna explains about the modes of nature also a little bit. This is the modes of nature. It will also come in 13th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. But we'll he will describe here in brief. Okay. So this we said right. There are three doers. Among the three doers, even among three doers, when it comes to jiva, the activities of the jiva are mostly carried out by the modes of material nature. Means this entire material creation can be divided into three modes of material nature. One is goodness, one is passion, and one is in ignorance. Everything, the date, the timings, that or the food, the wheat, or the type of dressing we do. Any activity in this material world can be divided into three modes of material nature. When we are situated in mode of goodness time, we will not be able to think very passionately or in ignorant way. It is said that early morning hours are in mode of goodness. So the person in mode of goodness, he wants to gain knowledge, and he performs austerities, he has steady determination. And he has sense control and regulated. So, and the mode of passion, this mode of passion is prominent after 7 o'clock in the morning, or especially 9 o'clock, 9 to 6 or 7 in the evening. There we do lot of passionate work. We work and we create and we maintain this material world. Okay. So it involves attraction between man and woman, intense longing for sense enjoyment, and hard work to acquire material wealth. So that is mode of passion. And mode of ignorance is lazy or procrastinate, nescience, sleep, madness, and intoxicant and angry. These are the activities in mode of passion. Okay. So when a person is situated in these modes, irrespective of when a person is situated in the mode of goodness, he will always try to do something constructive. Mode of passion is always more entangling, and mode of ignorance is degrading. Okay. So when we perform, as I said, we can dovetail all our activities in the service of Krishna. And when we act for the satisfaction of the Supreme Lord, then our consciousness will be elevated. And that kind of person who develops Krishna consciousness, he will see everything with equal vision. Means, he sees a brahmana, a chandala, a dog, elephant, or anything with equal vision. Means he respects everybody equally. But he also, it doesn't mean that we should go and embrace a tiger, because he is also a soul like that. We have to maintain distance, and we should respect from distance. Okay. So that is the person consciousness of the person who is consciousness is elevated by being in Krishna's service. Okay. Sambhul says, by the virtue of true knowledge, sees with equal vision a learned man, a gentle brahmana, and a cow, an elephant, a dog or dog eater or outcast. So he'll have the equal vision. He sees Paramatma in everybody's heart. Okay. Srila Prabhupada, when he came to US, he associated with the hippies, who are outcast in American culture. Okay. they don't have any good habit. They are always, you know, doing illicit sex, intoxication, gambling. But by giving them his association and gradually educating them and bringing them into knowledge, he was able to transform them totally, and they become a great devotees. No. So what are the symptoms? No, what are the symptoms of such a realized person, self-realized person? Such a self-realized person does not rejoice on something pleasant, does not lament on something unpleasant. He is fixed in intelligence, sthira buddhi, unbewildered, and knows the signs of God, and situated in transcendence, unattracted to material pleasures, and enjoys within. These are the symptoms of a self-realized person, or a person who acts in Krishna consciousness. So when we say he doesn't rejoice something pleasant, because like all our endeavors in this material world is to avoid suffering and to get something pleasant in our life, right? But this self-realized person acts, you know, as a matter of duty, and he doesn't rejoice for something pleasant, and means he doesn't overly joyous, overly joyful, you know, doesn't take anything, any favorable condition in his life materially as something rejoiceful, and isn't lament for something unpleasant. Means if you gain something, you are joyful. If you lose something, you are unpleasant, because these dualities will not exist in a such kind of person. He equally, you know, maintains his balance in both the situations. He is fixed in intelligence, means his dealings is on the spiritual level. When our dealings is on the spiritual level, we will be very much indifferent to this material conditions. So in this material conditions, sometimes very pleasant things happen, sometimes very unpleasant things happen. So there is a good chance that, you know, we are very much affected by our externals. No? But a Krishna conscious person will not be affected by these externals. Okay, and he is unbewildered, means his consciousness will not never be degraded. Means he not are polluted, and he knows the signs of God. No, he knows how the things work, how the karma works, and how to utilize everything in the service of Krishna. So, and he's always situated in transcendence, unattracted to the material pleasures, you know, because when he's attracted to the material pleasures, means when we develop strong desire for the material pleasures, then we actually make all the, it is the root cause for all the suffering. So it is said, right, Prahlad Maharaj says in Srimad Bhagavatam, the best way to, you know, remain in this world and be happy is try to stop endeavoring for material pleasures. And when something pleasurable comes in our life, we'll enjoy. Means like it doesn't mean like something pleasurable came and we didn't even recognize it. We should not recognize it. It's not like that. We be in this material world, but we don't hanker for anything. Sensory or like something which gives sensual pleasure. When we stop enduring for happiness, happiness will come to us. When we run after happiness, happiness will keep on going away from us. So what does it mean? We should be satisfied with whatever comes into our life. So we should try to maintain this self-satisfaction. We should be satisfied. Otherwise, there is no limit for the sense gratification or hankering for the material things. And he enjoys the pleasure within, realizing Paramatma. Means the self-realized person, he is always connected to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When he is connected to the Supreme Lord, then he sees everyone with equal vision. And he will have no enemies only. So, and no anxieties. That such a kind of person will attain the real peace. And such a kind of person will be able to see Paramatma in everybody's heart. And that way he is God conscious, or he is in connection with Krishna always, and he resides within. So after knowing this, all this knowledge, you know, like one can easily attain the liberation, like by applying this knowledge of Krishna consciousness. What is the sadhana for attaining liberation? Means freedom from sinful reaction, freedom from the dualities and doubts, mind being engaged within and working for everybody's welfare. These are the, like Krishna says in verse number 25, that by doing all these things, he can easily attain the liberation from the material suffering. Okay. And in the verse number 29, Krishna gives the ultimate peace formula, knowing Krishna through bhakti yoga. By a person full conscious of me, knowing me to the ultimate beneficiary of all sacrifices and austerities, the supreme lord of all the planets and demigods, and benefactor and well-wisher of the living entities, attains the peace from the pangs of material desires, material miseries. That is the peace formula. That's what Krishna is saying. Means, like when one ultimately understands that who is the ultimate beneficiary, you know, for whom we are working, then such kind of person, unless one understands that Lord Krishna is the master of the material nature and the conditioned souls, and under the strongest rules of material nature, it is not possible to achieve peace in the world, either individually or collectively. Krishna consciousness brings one into the spiritual life, even while one is within the jurisdiction of matter. For it is arousing of spiritual existence by practice in material world. So, if we get anything in our life, no, then like, you know, just like we'll be working on behalf of Krishna. So, for everything, no, for anything, like, you know, then if we know that Krishna is the ultimate beneficiary, and if we work with that, what you call, understanding, means that will keep us in the knowledge. Then when we think we are the enjoyer and we are the entitled for enjoyment, you know, we actually think, you know, without any restrictions I can enjoy, then there is a good chance that we identify with our externals, and there is a good chance that we become miserable in this material world. But when we understand that Krishna is the ultimate beneficiary, and when we are Krishna conscious in all of our activities, then by that knowledge, we'll be able to easily attain the perfection in our Krishna consciousness and attain the liberation from the material entanglement. So that is the essence of this chapter. If you have any questions or, you know, any comments, we can discuss here.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Pranam. So, Prabhuji, does that mean that, I'm always confused. Like, I mean, we should not work too hard for, in our work, or, you know, like, we should not too hard for, you know, like, a position or power.
Yeah, and like, you know, Mataji, like, working is, like, you know, karma is in our hands. We have to do our best. No, when we are in the working circle, we have to think that I am working for the pleasure of Krishna. Means I am working, this work is also given by Krishna. So we have to do our best. Like, the duty is in our hands, but we should not think that only if I get that position. For suppose if you are a you are a team lead, something like that, no, and you want to become a manager. I'll work so hard and I'll become a manager or project lead or something like that. So that working is in your hands. No, you have to give our best in all the spheres of our life, but we should not be result bounded. Yes, I'll be happy when only we get, you know, I get that benefit, you know. That's why when we are discussing the symptoms of self-realized person, he doesn't rejoice for something pleasant and doesn't lament for something unpleasant, you know. For suppose you are working a person, you are you are a team lead, something like that, and you wanted to get promoted to the project manager. If you can work and you can endure, but if you are too much attached, no, for the result, no, and if that if the company decides to, instead of you, if that position or anything is given to any of our colleague or anybody, then there is a good chance that we get disappointed. So the thing is, like, the working is in our hands, but when it comes, whatever comes to in our life, we may be not given promotion, or we will be asked to continue like that only, we should be happy. Okay, it is good for me. It might be for my good only. No? Like, there are some devotees who actually gave up their high paying jobs and took up low profile job just because the high paying jobs demands more of their time, and they cannot remain Krishna consciousness in their job. So when anything comes to us, without much of our endeavor, if you want to put more and more endeavor, means you have to spend more and more time on the metal platform. And if you're spending more and more in the metal platform, it will lead to this attraction to something pleasant, consume most of our energy. Like, so rather than that, if you lead a balanced life, enduring is there, you can put endeavor, but not attached to that. Okay, no, I endeavor, that's why result have to come on my way, like that.
Prabhuji,
yes, Prabhu.
Thank you.
Actually, but you said everything is karma based, no?
As I said, that I gave you cow example, right?
Yeah, accordingly, we need to act according to our karma. We cannot simply act. No? That is also Krishna's mercy.
What is it? Okay, probably, is it a question or comment?
No, question.
What is it?
But you said everything is karma based, no?
Not everything is karma based. See, okay. Prabhu, karma will only give the facilities, no? Like, our karma will, if we did good karma, it will bring you and keep you in a good, resourceful manner. Means you will be given a nice family, you will be, nice material facilities. You will have nice parents. So these are all due to good karma. You will get facilities, you will get environment, and you will get good intelligence due to good karma. But how you use that facilities will decide your future.
Okay.
So karma is only, as I said, when you do good karma, you are like, everybody is like a cow tied in a grassland. No? So if your karma is good, your rope will be longer and you will be able to enjoy more facilities.
No, your voice is breaking.
Sorry. Is it clear for now?
Okay, bro.
You're able to hear?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
One minute, Mother. I'm just clearing up this, Prabhuji.
Yeah, I can hear.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. Yes, Prabhuji.
So what I said is, when we have previous karma, it will decide our present facilities. Like what situation you have to take birth and how much happiness you have to get. That will be decided by our previous karma. But not the goal that you will be reaching the destination that you will be reaching is based on your present activities, present karma, but what you are going to do with your facilities now.
It is influenced by previous karma.
Yeah, by your previous karma, you will be made rich. You will be given you will be given millions of dollars, but how you use this $1,000,000 will define your future position. Future position. And you have that free will, how you utilize that. You understood, okay, right? So you should use that all the facilities very responsibly in a Krishna consciousness. That's how we progress in our spiritual life. And we get better destination in our next life also.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
So you said that the property that we don't belong, we should not be using that thing. So if we are given gift from someone which we haven't made any effort or work to get it, right? So we should be accepting that gift or just saying no to the gifts from people or family people or anybody.
So Mataji, in this world, everywhere there is a give and take policy. You know?
Huh.
And so when somebody gives you a gift, means in future you have to give them gift also, right?
Right.
So it is not like it is not coming for free. Okay. So you can take and you can enjoy, but you should not forget your responsibility that you should also reciprocate with them, like that.
But by mistake, if you forget, then it's your karma that you accepted
it's
something.
It's a karma is something which is, you know, like if somebody gives you a gift, means they are giving you the whatever the item or anything,
right.
Means like it is destined in your karma also that you receive something like this.
Okay.
But if you rob something without that right. person's knowledge, that is bad karma.
Okay.
That will give you negative reactions on your life. But if somebody gives a gift, obviously you'll accept it and you'll use it. And you'll be maintaining friendly disposition towards that position also, that person also.
Okay.
But based on our previous karma only, that object is coming to us, okay? You should remember that.
Right, so it's okay to...
It's okay to accept, Mata. It's not like...
No, okay.
Otherwise, it will be hypocritical.
Okay. Thank you.
Any more questions, Prabhupada? Okay, we'll end it here. Grandrashyanath Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Ananda Koti Vaishnava Vrinda ki jai. Thank you for joining. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Deepak Prabhu, you don't have any questions today?
Not for today's class. Though I have one question, but it's a confusion. In the chapter 2-3, it's from chapter 2-3. So it's super soul is unique, right? It's a one, not a different. It's a only one, right? What about soul? It's a different one. Suppose I have one soul, you have one soul. Whatever soul you have is the same as mine, or say it's a different one, it's identical.
No, every soul is different, Prabhu.
Oh, okay.
But the super soul is one. No?
Okay.
Just like, you know, if you see the sun in the sky and the reflection that our moon, the moon's reflection can be seen in different bodies, you know, water bodies. In a lake, you see, in a glass of water, you see the reflection of moon, or in any, or in a mirror, you see the reflection of moon. But there is one moon, but the images of moon are this different in different objects, right? In the same way, different living entities have that is the expansion of Krishna. That Parama super soul is the expansion of Krishna. Expansion of Krishna is called Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. So Vishnu residing along with the soul in each and every body, and each and every living entity has a unique swarupa, means it is its real nature. What is its identity in the spiritual world? So that's why every soul is individual. But the super soul is one. You understood, right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
So that's how then Krishna in all everybody's heart is one. But the soul in everybody's body is different. And they'll have different, every soul has unique relationship with Krishna, Prabhu. You know? Like just if you see when Krishna in Vrindavan, he is mother to Yashoda. He is son to Nanda Maharaj. No, sorry. Krishna is the son to Yashoda and Nanda Maharaj. And Krishna is a friend to his friends. And Krishna is a lover to his girlfriends. And Krishna is a master to the cows and his servants. Okay. So he has different unique relationship with each and every living entity also. And he has a different unique relationship with you. And other devotees also. So soul is different and Krishna is same. Did you understand?
Oh, okay. Yeah, Prabhuji, yeah.
Okay. Any more, Prabhu? We'll...
No, thank you so much, Prabhuji.
Thank you. Okay. Grandra Shima Dwagatam, Bhagavad Gita Kijay Shri
Prabhupada.
Bye. Bye, Prabhu. Question Artham Enda?
Artham, Prabhu. Okay. Very good. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for joining. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.